Thank you, Shankar, for being
here.
Good morning to everyone.
Thanks for having me.
You know, as some of you might know, Shankar is the founder of Plum. And as many, many entrepreneurs in the sort of consumer space, Shankar also comes from the actual sort of factory of CEOs, right? We actually recently did a cover in our advertising magazine Impact about, you know, many CEOs in our industry who are who come from an HUL background, and you've not just worked in HUL, but post that you were in private equity for some time, and now for the last 11 years you've been founder of Plum. So tell us, you know, what is it about HUL? I know Sudhir Sitapati wrote a book many years back about HUL being a CEO factory. What is it about the company that kind of grooms CEOs to become entrepreneurs? And now that you're a digital entrepreneur, what are the things you had to unlearn?
Firstly, thanks for having me and pleasure to be here. Just looking at the AV's play itself was quite inspiring, and I'm sure in the audience there's a lot of people out there that I can learn a lot from. And thanks for having me. I started with HUL 27 years back, but even as of day before yesterday, I was telling them what I was told on my day one at HUL. It is a very admin small thing. But that sticks to my mind that even if you forge a taxi fare, you're out of the company. That's the level at which the company works on ethics. And we were told that sleep well at night because this company does all the right things all the time. So I think first and foremost, just a very strong sense of doing the right thing, not crossing lines when it comes to compliance, not crossing lines when it comes to the law of the land. It's ingrained in you. That's the first thing. The second thing is, sort of language around the consumer. And I came from an engineering background. In fact, in HUL, I worked in the engineering side. I was on the production and product formulation side for 8 years before I went off to do my MBA and then moved into the world of marketing and finance. But the obsession with the consumer, and that's the first time I saw the consumer being referred as a she. Right. This was, I'm talking about again, 20, 25 years back. And that she has stuck into my head. So when I started Plum, it was founded for the she. And of course, a lot of he's also use it, including myself. But essentially, the picture in your mind of the consumer as a she, again, comes back from HUL. I think that's true for a lot of us who have sort of been in those years in HUL. I think these are two things that I will call out. One is a very strong sense of ethics, and the second is a very, very obsessive mindset about the consumer and fulfilling her needs in the best possible fashion. Digitally, I think we are also learning, you know, all of us are learning, but I think the fundamentals of these two don't change. HUL itself is now a sort of force to reckon with when it comes to how they've adopted digital. That's the other thing about HUL, that even though it is a behemoth in every sense of the word, but the way it keeps adapting and evolving, it's just phenomenal to see. A lot of respect.
Interesting, yeah. You know, you run a beauty wellness, you know, company, and this space has seen explosive growth in the last few years, right? What's your view? You know, a lot of, you know, investors talk about, you know, two kind of buckets, white space and, you know, disruption, right? And there are, of course, a lot of layers in between. As a, you know, entrepreneur, founder of a company for the last 11 years, what's your view? Is the space already very fragmented and cluttered, or you think there is space for much more? Obviously, it depends upon which side of the fence you sit on. And given that, you know, where the space today is, what is your outlook for the next few years in terms of, you know, will we see even more fragmentation in this space, or are you looking at, you know, this industry going through consolidation?
So I'll speak about the beauty and personal care industry, because D2C tends to be a very wide space with everything from food to luggage to apparel being part of it. Beauty and personal care, by its very nature, has a very long and fat tail of brands that even if you go abroad and see, it's not sort of winner take all, two player, three player market. It is by definition a multiplayer market. And you look at any sort of reasonably evolved country in the world of beauty and personal care, you probably see dozens of good brands, great brands. Many of them innovating, many of them sort of right at the leading edge of innovation and of being so close to the consumer. Now, the important thing here is, which we are also learning, is we should not have a static view of the world when it comes to, okay, here's my market share and here's what I do very well, and you know, this is what I'll continue to do for the next X number of years, especially with the pace at which marketing is changing, consumers' access to information is changing, behaviors and preferences are evolving. I think brands which evolve with these, and it's a slightly paradoxical thing that I'm about to say. As a brand, you have to evolve with these preferences also shifting, yet remains true to the core of what the brand is about.
Yes.
Being able to balance this out is an everyday task. Every day we are faced with choices. Should I do this? Should I not do this? Should I do more of this? Should I do less of this? At every point in time, we have to be guided by where, at one hand, where the consumer is. On the other hand, is this true to what the brand is about? And it's a very sort of thin line that you have to walk to remain relevant in the market. As we've seen so many brands which are great brands in their own right, but if they fail to evolve, they suddenly just start. You know, it ends up being in a very drastic situation just a few years down, and that's how fickle the market has become. And I think that fickleness is giving a lot of room for new brands to emerge. But my view is, no matter how many new brands emerge, the brands that continue to evolve, adapt, and remain true to themselves as well as to what the customer is thinking about are the ones that are going to survive and thrive.
Yeah, interesting, and also a lot of innovation that is happening in the space. Absolutely, I remember your example about the Kajal and the, you know, pencil. Maybe, you know, this is a slightly different audience. You might want to tell them what you did. And it's a very, very interesting example. Shankar spoke about it at our India Brand Conclave in February. And I'm sure you've spoken about that at many other fora. Yeah. Why don't you tell us a little bit about that?
Sure. It's a very, what shall I say? It's a very micro thing. But I'm glad that you remember. Quite amazed, actually. So we launched a Kajal, and along with it, we thought we'll give a sharpener free. This is a sharpenable Kajal pencil, and those of you who use Kajal pencil know that we have this little purple Kajal pencil that Plum is well known for. And when we started out with the Kajal, we went for a PVC free barrel because we wanted to be sort of more earth friendly in our choices. PVC has a very soft, as a plastic is very soft, so it sharpens quite well. Many of the Kajal pencils you see are either made of wood back then or now made of PVC, the barrel that is there. When we made a PVC-free barrel, we didn't realize that it's going to be a little harder to sharpen than your usual softer PVC. We realized it after we launched. Of course, we should have known this before we launched. I didn't expect that it's going to be this different. Neither did the manufacturer tell us. So what happened was, we started getting feedback that I can't sharpen this Kajal. So, I started visiting customers' homes to understand how they actually sharpen the Kajal and what gets stuck in it, how do they clean it. It's a very small thing, but for them it was a big pain because they've spent $500 buying a Kajal pencil that they can't use after the first thing is over, right? And then at least 16 to 20 models of sharpeners, including from Germany, we tried, tested, finally found one sharpener that works. Even there we had a problem of the blade being misaligned. And that again took another customer home visit for me to understand that actually some of these blades are not working. And when I gave feedback to the German sharpener manufacturer that, listen, we actually found a small sort of misalignment in your blade. And being a German, they were like aghast. They said, this cannot happen. I sent the videos, I sent the samples. I think the long story short, the moral of the story is, I still distinctly remember which customers' homes I went to and what they exactly told me about this. But it's so ingrained in my mind, and this sort of real incident has sort of laid the path for us to always think consumer sort of context when we are thinking of product design and innovation. And not just that, when how we take feedback and how we listen to them. Initially, we were quite dismissive, saying, no, I think it's, you know, it's probably humid, it's raining, whatever, all kinds of stories we were giving, but the barrel would have swollen up and all that. Then we actually go and visit this when we realize that these small things make a huge impact in their lives. So thanks for referring to that again.
That's the other thing with, you know, what HUL, you know, ingrains in you. Market visits, meet your customer. You know, the first few years you spend in sales, you're on ground visiting, you know, smaller markets, villages, living in Bihar, Eastern UP, and, you know, trying to meet customers to understand exactly, you know, what they're looking at. Let me, you know, talk a little bit more about marketing now, Shankar. And, you know, we've all seen the increasing sort of impact of technology on marketing. But tell us some, you know, granular details. What would, for example, it mean for a category like yours? You know, where are the key areas where, you know, technology has really made a very big difference, and, you know, you see, you know, plethora of opportunities opening up as we go along?
I mean, I must admit that I come from a very A, non-marketing and B, traditional sort of worldview background. And what I see in terms of how MarTech is evolving and into programmatic and into AI and all the other, it's very intellectually interesting for me, yet from a business POV, quite challenging to keep pace. But it makes life very interesting is all I can tell you. I was actually thinking about how are we leveraging or not leveraging technology in what we do. And if you really break it down into strategy and planning, production of the assets, deployment and engagement, I think a lot of, it's actually moving on all fronts. If you really break down the marketing sort of tasks into these four, and I'm sure there are other ways to break it, but I was breaking this down into these four. I think in the biggest sort of, opportunity lies in strategy and planning, which is what we saw in some of the AVs that played before this session started, is the amount of data that is sitting out there is sort of difficult to fathom. And every day we are exposed to new sets of data, new ways to look at data. Just yesterday we were looking at how it is possible to look at dark store availability and dark store search patterns and sales patterns in quick commerce, which did not even exist 6 months back. Now suddenly that opens up like a torrent of data in front of you. And that has implication on how you advertise, where you advertise, what you advertise. Why should I advertise something that is not in stock in that particular geography, for example? So strategy and planning, you can keep fine-tuning your spend to the point where you are, you know, hypothetically uber optimal in terms of how you spend and what you spend it on, which is what many of these platforms and what AI and ML is going to take us to, which is what you referred to in your address as well. So strategy and planning is where we are seeing the biggest changes happening, biggest opportunities also, but also the toughest challenge for brands like us to keep pace, because things are changing so fast, things are getting thrown at you at such a pace that by the time you are thinking that you have mastered something, you are beginning to look at something else new that has come in. So, but yet, as I said, it makes life interesting. Where I have personally found a lot of childlike joy in the use of technology is in production. So in our 10th birthday in July, one of our team members made a fully AI-generated video. It's actually quite nice. So it kept zooming in. And for me to have thought of having somebody produce that video in-house with the kind of animation that we're talking about would have been impossible. That was completely AI-generated. And with AI generation, even designed t-shirts, we've designed photo shoots and all that. So I think that in very small ways, AI is beginning to change how content is produced. And that's a big relief for somebody like me who keeps listening from my team saying, I don't have enough designers. I say, okay, finally I have an answer for you. At least 30% of your routine work can be done by AI. Remaining 70% creative stuff, human stuff, you still need designers for that. I mean, I need somebody to tell me if it is looking good or not. At that level, last but not the least is on engagement, including the use of chatbots, including the use of CRM, getting more and more intelligent about how I am talking to consumers. So if I really break down the marketing task into these three or four buckets, there's so much happening each one of those. The challenge is really to identify which are the ones we need to go after and invest behind.
But tell me, yeah, interesting point you brought up regarding AI and, so there are two, points on this. One is there a risk of overdoing it, right? The human touch, because I'm sure all of us in this room have experienced chatbots that are going berserk, right, who are just giving you standard answers. So, the risk of not using it judiciously, just blindly implementing it, what is the downside of that? The other part is also about, when you look at storytelling, the human touch is what brings in the sort of real essence of the brand, right? When you allow a machine or ask a machine to do that, that touch goes away. It might be there 2 out of 10 times, but 8 out of 10 times, you might not get it right. So is there a risk of kind of over depending upon that and, losing the plot?
Absolutely. And I think particularly in a space like ours where there's a lot of brands vying to do the same thing, there's a risk of looking very predictable, cookie cutter, fill in the blanks. The one person launches snail mucin, there's like some 10 brands of snail mucin all talking the same thing. And I'm like, hang on, where is this even going? At least think of something new to talk about. But that snail mucin insight itself being thrown up by data. suddenly it says Snail Mucin is the top selling product everywhere, and then there's a FOMO and everybody rushes in. And then you start creating stuff around it which begins to look very mechanistic. I think the good news which I have seen shine through like sort of sunlight on a cloudy day through all of this is that human beings are essentially beings of the heart. We may think with our minds, but we decide with our hearts, especially in categories like ours, lifestyle, fashion, beauty. These are very, there's something in their heart, mind, whatever, however you define it, which is beyond just the hard data, beyond just the ingredients, beyond just what I'm saying on the packaging, beyond just things like price. So as marketers for us, and each customer vibes with a certain brand for a certain need that she has, right? As marketeers, I think it's important for us to, and that's where the human bit comes in, that I need to understand what I vibe with, why she likes me in her life, at what points and for what needs and in what fashion and in what fashion does she sort of vibe with the brand, and that's what I need to stay true to, which goes back to staying true to the brand. Her needs may keep evolving, but she likes the brand for a certain thing that it says or does, or the way it says or does it. And that you cannot, at the moment, basis what I see, I don't think that can be quote-unquote mechanized. There is definitely a sort of human element that is very, very strongly needed there. The one last thing I'll say here is, even though social media is also as algorithmic a platform as you can imagine, I've seen that the people's ability to read through all of that and get the sort of heart of it, essence of it, is very, very, very high. It's at some level very intuitive and very pleasing to see.
So tell me, if I deep a little bit sort of more into the marketing side of the beauty business, and I'm sure you map the whole category, what established legacy brands are doing versus what, you know, newer brands like yours are doing. There are a lot of agency partners in the room, right? And I'm sure you've seen all sorts of work being done across the table, especially in storytelling, content curation. What are the sort of, you know, things you've seen? One obviously is, you know, a lot of repetition, you know, similar work happening. It's like the Hindi film industry, you know, one movie, right, action movie does well, and there are like 20 more spin-offs on similar lines. So advertising also has a tendency of, you know, falling into that trap. What are the other areas you've seen where, you know, you think improved work can be done, areas where, you know, the beauty industry, the kind of messaging that is being created is still kind of, you know, untouched?
I think the one area is this beauty codes, right? Glass skin, bright skin, glowing skin, shiny hair, whatever are these quote-unquote beauty codes. I think we are using a lot of universal terms without even understanding what we are talking about. And that's true of us also. I'm not saying we are not doing it. I keep challenging myself and our team to say, what do you really mean when you say glass skin? And the term didn't exist one year back, but suddenly it's like the trending term and everybody's jumping on saying glass skin. I think it's very important to step back, think, what is it that you're actually talking about? Again, going back to how is it relevant to the customers or consumers here? It may be a passing fad, but I think not jumping on every bandwagon that is out there and crafting things which are meaningful to the Indian context. And to the evolving consumer who is also willing to pay a premium for the stuff that she likes and does the job that she wants it to do. I think that's the one thing that I would say all of us as brands need to do better off. Otherwise, it's somewhat frustrating and even boring at times to look at the same keyword trending on all the products that I'm talking about. And, you know, I mean, I definitely don't like existing in that kind of world. That's not what I thought I was getting into. So we keep trying to challenge and study, move out from the Googleization, as I call it, of innovation, yeah, the keywordization of innovation. That's very unfortunate when it happens, because what that does is, in a way, the supply is impacting the nature of the demand, which is sort of, you know, not the best of things to happen. So I'm hopeful that people's sort of humanness will overtake overtake the algorithms which are trying to overtake our thinking, in a manner of speaking.
So I see we are almost out of time. I'll ask you one last question, which has been a perennial debate, especially in the last you know, decade or so in marketing, especially with the advent of digital advertising, is about, you know, whether to focus more on building your brand or performance. And a lot of D2C brands have focused on, you know, performance marketing, generating overnight ROI. Though some marketers have a view that, you know, every marketing has to be performance, even if you are sponsoring and putting big bucks in IPL sponsorship. Right. How have you, you know, found that balance? What is your view on the subject?
That's a perennial debate, but I must say that as one grows in scale, the debate tends to settle down a bit. Initially, of course, when I was bootstrapping and, you know, we were Series A and whatnot, every rupee needs to sort of convert, in a manner of speaking. But now the stage at which we are realizing that it is ultimately brand building that wins the day for you, whether it is on a beauty platform, whether it is in a retailer sort of 1 kilometer away from here, whether it is on a quick commerce platform, whether it is on your own D2C platform, it doesn't matter what channel you are selling to. Most important thing is to build a brand. I'm sorry, again, I go back to the same thing that we started off with. Are you occupying a special place in the consumer's mind and heart? There are a million ways to do it, and there are a million machine-driven ways to do it also today. But ultimately, again, your question on human versus machine, I think it's a great way to also end the chat, is to say all that we are doing here through all the algorithms and all the programmatic and all the AI is ultimately to win that place in their mind. The next time they are going to buy a face wash or a moisturizer or a shampoo or whatever that is selling, you are in their consideration set of the top two or three brands that they like. And that is a function of what you mean to her or mean to him as a brand in that need state that they exist. And that's something we need to keep sort of aligning ourselves to every single day.
Fantastic. Thank you, Shankar, for a insightful, candid conversation. We don't have time for questions. We can take them outside once Shankar is off stage. Thank you again for,
thanks once again,
you know, giving us time.